Hello, everybody, and welcome to today's it's a Ask Me Anything webinar. We got together just because we thought it would be a great idea to have a chance to kind of share a little bit of the updates on the International Token Standardization Association. Also, give a very brief intro for those that don't know what we do yet, and then really just have a chance for everybody participating to ask myself and my colleague Christian any questions you might have about the project. Or any of the projects we're working on, as well as the future. So I'm going to begin the session with quickly sharing a few slides just to give an overview and a reminder of what ITSA does and what we are. And then just touch on the ITIN, where we're standing with that and where we're moving with it, and then hand over to Christian, who will talk about the ITC and the new dimensions we have there. If you have any questions, please at any time post them into the live stream chat. And we'll be sure to read them and answer them as they come in. So without further ado, I'm gonna quickly share. Fantastic. So essentially, this is our quick executive summary of the ITSA, right? We're a Berlin-based not-for-profit association of German law, and we have about just under 200 international members. And the idea is that we want to promote, develop, and also implement market standards for blockchain and essentially any DLT-based cryptographic tokens. The idea behind it is that through these market standards, we want to create more safety, more transparency, and a little bit more order on the global token markets. And we do it through two projects and one database, which brings it together. So the projects are the International Token Identification Number, which serves as a unique and fork-resilient identification for DLT-based tokens, as well as the ITC, International Token Classification Framework, which is right now a 10-dimensional expandable framework for the classification of tokens according to their kind of main characteristics or most important kind of characteristics. And both of these things are kind of complementary and come together in the international token database, the token base, where you can then look up tokens, look up their ITIN, as well as their full ITC classification. So give a quick update, just to give you an idea of who we are. These are some of our selected members. So you can see it's quite a broad range from really from startups, from kind of the old world. So we have some banks, right? Some big exchanges like the Deutsche Börse, the Börse Stuttgart, Bank Frick, but also some really startups and new world and DeFi like Maker and Swarm Capital, Swarm Markets, Blocksize Capital, as well as some STO firms like Cashlink and like. So we're really set up quite broadly in the ecosystem, but we have a touch on every part of it, on regulation, on digital assets and traditional asset management, on decentralized finance. And we just try to kind of bring it together under an umbrella that is beneficial for all, hence the market standards that cover all of these different areas of blockchain and crypto markets. So I'm just going to start here, I think, because this is a good segue to start on what the current progress of the ITIN is. So to those that don't know, the ITIN is a 8-digit alphanumeric identifier with a checksum at the end. And it's used kind of, you can imagine it as analogous to the ISIN, right? The number you use for identifying financial securities, but for tokens and for the token there. And the comparison you have here is that on the left, we see the ISIN and the FIGI, which are the two identifiers that we would use for the asset layer. So in particular, these are for financial securities, financial instruments. In the case of the ISIN, they are the ISO standard. The FIGI is not. They are issued by either Bloomberg or the national numbering agencies and ANA, and either upon request or proactively. And the idea for these is that they may apply to security tokens or tokens that are really re very relevant for capital markets. But they leave out quite a big spectrum of the tokens, and really they would be used to identify the asset layer. So if I'm tokenizing a financial security, these two would be used to identify this financial security that I'm tokenizing, but not the actual token itself. So in contrast, we have the DTI and the ITIN, which would be used both to identify said token, so the token layer of it. We have the ESIN on the asset and then the DTI or the ITIN on the token layer. The difference here is that the DTI, the digital token identifier, again, it has, like the ISIN to the Fiji, it has the ISO standard. It's developed by E-Trading Software and the DTI Foundation, who are also looking at a proactive and upon request assignment. And it is applied to all fungible digital assets that are relevant to capital markets. So the scope here is not for every single token out there, but still a relevant amount. In particular, of course, those tokens, like security tokens, that are particularly relevant to capital markets. In contrast, the ITIN is assigned actually free of charge, proactively, like the others, but we can apply this to all fungible and non-fungible tokens. So not only do we identify security tokens, maybe the most important cryptocurrencies that are for some reason relevant to capital markets because there are some ETPs based on them or fund setup, but actually all of them. So we can also cover liquidity provider tokens, any kind of NFTs, stable coins, any kind of wrapped tokens, which we're seeing a lot of right now in the DeFi space. All of those things also fall under the scope of the ITIN. And we don't have a standard, and so we don't have an ISO standard or authority that we have to clear first whether or not we can assign an ITIN. We, ITSA, can assign an ITIN to every token out there if needed. And this is how we plan to cover the entire market and make sure that there's transparency and a certain level of order everywhere. So this is, I think this makes sense to show. This is what I spoke about earlier or just now with differentiating between the asset layer that we have on top and the actual token layer on the bottom. So if we go, for example, to where we can see shares, Apple stock, right? On the asset layer, this is really identified by the ISIN and by the Fiji. But when we move on to tokenize it, we now have a token layer as well, right? We have the tokenized Apple shares, tokenized Apple stock, which is then identified by the ITIN. And one reason we need it is because, of course, these Apple shares don't have to be tokenized only on Ethereum, right? There are multiple protocols that allow for tokenization when it comes to securities. So we can have multiple different versions of tokenized Apple shares running on different ledgers. And in the future, maybe even with different utilities attached to them, maybe some will automatically pay out dividends, maybe some won't. So there's an important differentiation. And of course, for lawmakers, for regulators, it is important to know whether you're holding Apple stock as the actual share on the asset layer or whether you're holding a tokenized version of it. And this is the ITIN. This is what it looks like. The idea is that these characters in the beginning are completely random and real world words are eliminated. So there will never be an ITIN that has the word coin or bit or token in some sense in it, right? This is just important for fairness reasons. And we can assign over 800 billion of these. So we're really not worried. I don't think we're going to run out of them in the near future when it comes to token markets. And I think this would be a good space to move on to Christian, who can present the ITC. Christian, I will let you share now, and then you can show your part.
Yes, great, Max. So, correct. Max just gave an introduction to the ITIN, which is basically our identification data. And what we basically do is a token base. We connect the identification data. So we basically look at all the different tokens running on all the different chains, on all the different chains. We identify them. And then the second step would be the classification. And for the classification, we rely on the International Token Classification Framework, which is, just like Max already said, expandable and currently entails 10 different dimensions. I would now just quickly, I would also just share the link with Max so that he maybe can post it also in the chat of the live stream, mm-hmm. so that you can also take a look at it while I'm explaining it, or maybe even afterwards, if you want to take a closer look at it, all the different dimensions. But for now, basically, we had six dimensions, and this year we basically extended the ITC by another four. And as you can, for example, see up here, we have four different dimension groups. So the first one is the economic dimensions. Then under the economic dimensions, we first have the economic purpose, which, for example, checks for the utility of the token. Is it a payment token? Is it a utility token? Or is it an investment token? Then next, we would, under the economic dimensions, have the issuer industry, which then, for example, looks, okay, in what industry has the token been issued? Just like plain overview here at the beginning, for example, agriculture, mining, utilities, and construction. In that field, we mostly only see security tokens. But if we go a bit further, we come, for example, to the category information, communication, IT. And here we basically see a lot of blockchain projects like Ethereum or Filecoin or Monero that all fall into this category. And for these categories, we basically follow the North American Industry Classification Standard, but we have also extended the standard by additional categories and subcategories, so that we have, for example, here further through in the dimension under finance and insurance, that we also have, for example, decentralized finance, because obviously there's a lot of new trends currently happening in the total token universe and the blockchain ecosystem, and we always have to adapt basically for all the new trends in the ITC. And this is why we, for example, have also put a big focus on decentralized finance applications. Just to go through the ITC a bit further, next we would, for example, have the technological setup. Then we, for example, look at the token, if it's, for example, a native token, which is, for example, the case for Ethereum. But then we also have application layer tokens, which refers to tokens who originated from smart contracts. So they're not natively supported by the ledger. Then in the next dimension, we would, for example, take a look at the legal dimensions, legal claim. So we would look, for example, does a token holder have any rights towards a third party? For example, this is the case with USDC or with Tether. So if I hold a USDC or a Tether token, and I go, for example, to Tether Limited and I ask them to redeem my Tether coin for a dollar note, basically I have to right to do so. And therefore, it would, for example, classify as relative rights token. Bitcoin, on the other hand, or Ethereum, and there's no claim associated with holding this token towards a third party, so it would clearly classify as no claim token. And absolutely right, for example, a tokenized art piece, which basically is not fractionized and basically refers directly to this one piece of art. Then we, for example, come to the fifth dimension, where we take a look at the issuer type. We have here, for example, the differentiation between legal entities and entities without legal personality. This is here really important because the first basically always refers to token projects, which either originated from the government agencies. This would be, for example, CBDCs, so central bank digital currencies would fall into public sector legal entity. But then we also have private sector legal entity, which very much entails, for example, foundations or like normal companies who are for profit and who have basically issued a token via an ICO, for example. But then second, we would, for example, have entities without legal personality. And first, we have the distributed ledger protocol, which refers mostly for now to like protocols which run over proof of work, and where basically the software itself issues the tokens, which is then, for example, the case right now for Ethereum or for Bitcoin. And then last, we would, for example, also have something like application layer tokens. A good example here is, for example, the DAI stablecoin. The DAI stablecoin is issued by the MakerDAO application. The MakerDAO foundation is currently dissolving, so it's really right now turning into a DAO. And therefore, if there's, for example, DAI minted in the protocol, it would be regarded as application layer protocol as issuer type. And then last year, we have added also the dimension regulatory status in the EU. We all know that MiCA is the regulation that's going to affect the whole crypto market, the whole token market. And there's also differentiation between different tokens, for example, asset reference token, e-money tokens, which very much focuses on, for example, stable coins, non-authorized, authorized, significant, non-significant. that's always certain differentiation is obviously ITSA cannot give like 100% precise classification on how which token would at the end be really classified according to Mika, but we always take a close look at every token and we want to basically give here a best guess. It's also the case because the proposal hasn't been yet come into law, so this will definitely take some more time until there everything has been finalized. And then basically what I want to talk a bit today, just to give you like an idea about what we basically do at ITSA and also how we work. So basically, the ITC, like the whole, all of the dimensions you're currently seeing in here in the document are basically created in our second project working group, the ITC working group. And we are there like, I would say always between like 10 and 20 people discussing on like current token trends. And what we usually do is in the first half of the year, we basically discuss all together in a group. And we try to find new dimensions or new categories. It not always has to be in like a completely new dimension. Sometimes it's also just, for example, new categories or subcategories, which could be added to basically give more detail, to basically increase transparency on the token market. And in that regard, we, for example, this year extended the investment token category with further subcategories according to the CFI. So there we are following the ISO standard. But for this year especially, we basically added four new dimensions, and I will just quickly go over them, give you like a little idea about what is really important for us and how do we look at these things, because we know that there's also other classification frameworks out there, but something that we always have realized is that a lot of them are very complex and they are really hardly applicable. And when we basically developed these classification framework these dimensions here at ITSA, we really take a look at whether the dimension is applicable, and second, whether it follows like the best practice for ISO standards or in general standards. So basically, that this is also has a strong foundation in that regard. And for example, for the seventh dimension, this year we were saying, okay, we have already the technological setup, like the different standards, whether it's native token, ERC-20 token, or ERC-721 token, all the different token standards. But what's the second important component, technological wise, would be, for example, the consensus mechanism. And there, we basically took a look at several token taxonomy frameworks, just focusing on consensus mechanisms. And then we came up with a differentiation according to these categories. So first, for example, we would have the proof-based consensus mechanisms. Proof-based usually have like a scarce resource, which is, for example, the stake with proof of stake or the computational power in proof of work. And basically all these kind of proof of stake, proof of work based consensus mechanism are entailed into the proof based consensus mechanisms. But then we have also discovered that certainly there's way more than just like proof based consensus mechanism. There's, for example, also stuff like delegated proof of stake, where I have to delegate my stake to a third party. And then basically this party is the validator for the network and is then validating blocks basically with the token that I have assigned to him. And this basically makes part of the hybrid consensus mechanism category. And in that regard, we have called it hybrid. Why? Because there's some part of voting included into that. And basically the third big category that we basically have here in the ITC would be, for example, the voting-based consensus. And in that regard, the hybrid consensus is basically a mix out of voting and proof-based. And therefore, delegated to proof of stake is a typical hybrid consensus mechanism that we have basically then put in here. Just shortly about the voting-based consensus mechanisms, it's very interesting because especially like in the last month or in the last year, we have seen a lot of new ledgers popping up utilizing voting-based consensus. For example, I would say something like Phantom. Phantom, for example, uses acyclic Byzantine fault-tolerant consensus mechanisms. And that's also how they get such a high scalability. Just a short notice, because this is also quite detailed. If you have like questions concerning the voting base, you can also maybe ask them later. But just for now, one of the main differences, for example, between voting and proof-based is, for example, that in voting-based consensus mechanisms, the nodes are not pseudo-anonymous, like they are, for example, in Bitcoin, where everybody can just like run a node and doesn't have to give out his name, basically to assign it to his or her node. This is different for example, voting-based consensus mechanisms. We see, for example, that Stellar and Ripple, I would say the two most prominent voting-based consensus mechanism tokens, rely on federated Byzantine Agreement, FBA. They just have around 160, 170 nodes, so they are way more centralized than, for example, Bitcoin or Ethereum. On the other hand, they are way more scalable and they therefore can proceed way more transactions. So this was, for example, one thing we were taking a look at this year, at the consensus mechanisms. We are aware that the consensus mechanism is more affecting the ledger than always a token, but certainly also application layer tokens have some relationship to the consensus mechanism, so that there's also some part that this is being explained by this dimension. Let's just go to the next one. To give you like some more examples, next we would, for example, have the type of maximum supply. Bitcoin is, for example, fixed. Ethereum was now for a very long time inflationary. But what are we seeing right now? Well, right now we are seeing, okay, Ethereum, for example, has switched to like a totally different concept. We have now basically two factors. The first one is proof of work, which basically means a new token as like rewards. For computing new blocks. And then second, we have basically the burning process of the base fee, which is basically a deflationary factor. And overall, we are currently seeing that the supply of Ethereum, for example, is going down. So it's very interesting to see basically how things are sometimes just one-sided, and then over time, basically, new ideas are implemented, just like now with Ethereum. And then we, for example, see there are a lot of dynamics on the market in that regard. And therefore, for example, right now, because Ethereum is right now de facto like reducing its supply, we would, for example, classify it as deflationary. But certainly, I mean, this is only right now the case. This could also like change again in the future, and then we would have to take a look at Ethereum and update the token base entry. And discretionary, a good example is here, as I already said before. If you want to borrow some DAI against, for example, your collateral in the MakerDAO application, you basically borrow it from the application itself, and then basically it's just dependent on user demand, and therefore it would be regarded as discretionary in its maximum supply. Then in the ninth dimension, basically this time we were taking a look at the mode of origination. There we have five different categories. The first one, reward, for example, refers to a token which has been issued currently like 51% of the circulating supply. That's basically what we're looking at here. 51% of the circulating supply as a reward from computing power, which would be, for example, proof of work, or staking from proof of stake. But then we also have, for example, sales. It doesn't matter if public or private. We were first also thinking about maybe like splitting it into two categories, but very often there's actually two sales taking place. So it's not always very like clear what's basically like the primary mode of origination. So we only kept it with sale itself. Then something that has become also very popular, I would say, in the last 1.5 years are airdrops. I think currently DYDX was like making a huge airdrop, and I think there was also a lot of news around that. Airdrops are like very interesting for two components. First, it's very nice for community building because it's a nice incentive, right? So if there's, for example, like a new protocol somewhere popping up in the DeFi space on a second layer solution right now for Ethereum, then these applications, they want to attract new users. And for that, basically, they give incentives in regard to airdrops. And then basically, people have, for example, to transfer some of the Ethereum, for example, to second layer solution. And once they have done so, they get rewarded with a certain DeFi token, which holds a certain value. Then next, this is, I think, one of the most interesting categories in this dimension is basically the wrapping dimension, where we really take a look at token bridges. So, for example, one really famous bridge is, for example, the Binance bridge, which connects the Binance Smart Chain with Ethereum and with two, three other chains. And basically, the bridge allows me to move, for example, BNB from the Binance Smart Chain to Ethereum, or I can move Ethereum to the Binance Smart Chain. And basically every time when I do that, I have to lock the tokens in the smart contract. On the other chain, basically my tokens basically get minted as a wrapped version. And then basically I can interact with my original token on the second chain. And this is something that is becoming more and more important, I think, especially in the recent months, because we are seeing like interchain operability is becoming a huge topic at the moment. And therefore, in the field of wrapping, we currently see a lot of tokens popping up. I will also show later an example in regard to the wrapping process. And therefore, this is something that we very much take a look at it right now at ITSA. And then basically our last dimension maybe looks a bit simple, but actually is also a very smart one, because here we have followed the OECD standards, which got published at the end of 2020. And here we are differentiating between conventional asset tokens and new asset tokens. New asset tokens would be, for example, Bitcoin, Ethereum, basically every cryptocurrency like that is really regarded as cryptocurrency, while conventional asset tokens would more refer to tokenized equity, tokenized debt, but also, for example, stablecoins. So, for example, USDC or USDT, they basically replicate like real-world currencies. So basically, they would be regarded as conventional asset token. And this category is now actually quite interesting because if you think about the Ripple case is exactly what basically this category is about. So basically, Ripple Labs is arguing, hey, Ripple is not a security, it's basically a cryptocurrency, it's a new asset token, while the SEC clearly argues, oh no, this has been a security offering, and therefore we would classify it as a conventional asset token. This dimension is, by the way, also a second interesting thought. Right now, Bitcoin has become legal tender in El Salvador. I think yesterday came the news that also Brazil is currently thinking about adopting Bitcoin, and that the fact that El Salvador has adopted Bitcoin as legal tender also raises the question of, okay, is Bitcoin now still a new asset token, or would it be now concerned as a foreign exchange and therefore a conventional asset token? So this category is actually, I think, very smart in that regard, that it really tries to basically puts like crypto tokens into like the two different groups. Is it like a true cryptocurrency, cryptographic tokens, or is it more like tokenized assets out of the real world, which basically now are there in a digital form? And now to just quickly display you what we do with all the classification data, we basically list it here in the token base, which can be accessed via api.itsa.global. And then here, you can basically select all the different categories that you have seen before in the dimension overview table. And then, for example, we could, for example, select USD pegged payment token. And then if we then click on search, you can basically display here all like stable coins with a peg to the US dollar. And as you can already see here, we have, for example, five different DAIs. We have three different Binance USD. And behind that, basically, we always have currently written the chain that the stable coin is running on. And this is because I can also display it here. So basically, if you go up here on token lists, we also have here some token lists. And one of them is, for example, Tether. And if you click on Tether, you can basically see, hey, here is actually already 13 Tether tokens listed in the token base. And this is exactly what also Max was basically explaining before with the ITIN. We have to identify tokens on a token layer instead of an asset layer, because it's nice to evade basically this complexity. But on the other hand, a Tether token on, for example, Algorand is just not the same as a Tether token on Ethereum. They have different technological standards. Each token on each chain has basically its own market cap. There's like constantly tokens moving from one chain to the other. That's also what I meant before with interchain operability, and basically how all the different chains are currently connecting with one another. And the fact that basically Tether is already running on 13 different chains shows exactly that what I also said before, that we see like this token universe expanding in all different directions, interchain operability, and that basically now DeFi is not only focusing, for example, on Ethereum, but also that we currently see on Avalanche or Solana. There's a lot of things happening, Arbitrum. So I think it's a very exciting time to actually observe how the token universe is like expanding in all the different directions and yeah, creating like a huge network. And then a last thing I would like shortly to say before I hand over again to Max. Here's, for example, a token list with idle tokens. That's, for example, a DeFi protocol with lending and borrowing services. We at ITSA will certainly take a very close look in the next few months at the DeFi market in general, and also publish more articles about that, because we think, especially in the DeFi space, there's a lot of chaos. I mean, it's a very unregulated market yet. And for example, for security tokens, it's already completely different. And if you, for example, look here at the idle tokens, we have, for example, here the idle governance token. If you, for example, click on the token, you, for example, see here the ITC classification of the token, and then you see basically the different properties that the token has. And also here, very interesting is, for example, the idle WBTC token. WBTC is basically a wrapped version, as referring to the dimension we had before, a wrapped version of Bitcoin. And what is IDLE doing? Yeah, IDLE is basically wrapping this token again a second time. So basically we have a wrapped token of a wrapped token, which again features an individual token address. So this token again needs to be identified by an individual item, and then be basically classified on its characteristics. And this is also why basically this work we do here at ITSA is so important, because we really take a look at like the whole token universe. We try to identify each individual token, we classify it, we list it in the token base, and then basically we give to each token like a market price data feed, so that each token individually can be analyzed. And for that, I think I'm done now with the ITC. I would now hand over back to Max.
Fantastic, Christian. Thank you for that. So I don't have a new screen to share, but instead just going to give some more general updates. Christian, if you could stop.
Mm-hmm.
Just some further general updates that we have from our side. So we recently held our general assembly for all of our members, where we firstly elected a new executive board. So the old board was discharged, and the new board now consists of the chairman, Professor Dr. Philip Sandner from the Frankfurt School Blockchain Center, Vice Chairman Agatha Ferreira from the University of Vienna and the Nova School of Law, as well as Vice Chairman Konstantin Ketz, who is also co-founder of ITSA. We've added as a secretary, Peter Eulberg from AnyBlock Analytics, and Niels Bunny from ADPAR as a vice secretary. So both of these have been very involved with ITSA in the past. Peter Eulberg through AnyBlock is a partner of ours in regards to our kind of data and IT infrastructure. And Niels Bunny has been one of the main, or one of the driving forces, if not the driving force behind the ITIN development and its continued development and the continuation of the ITIN working group. Then as treasurer, we have Klaus Himmer, who was at CryptoTax, briefly BlockPit, and now at Flick Grocke Schaumburg, really an expert on tax-related questions when they're in regards to crypto and blockchain. And as vice treasurer, Benjamin Horvath, who has also been with us for quite some time now. He is managing director at LockRocket, which is an early stage crypto VC investing in blockchain-based business models. So this is the new executive board. It's, I believe, voted for a period of a year. And the idea with them now is to, well, along with Christian and myself, continue the trajectory that we've started on this year and move towards really stronger operations and more penetration of the market across the world. So for example, we've been expanding in Asia with some strategic partners there in the form of Toko. So they're Tokenizer and DLA Piper. We're moving towards Brazil and Latin America as well. We've recently gained Mercado Bitcoin Digital Assets as a member, as well as Bitrust Custody, the only Brazilian crypto custody provider, and kind of disseminating our network there further. So that's the strategy that we're going for the rest of the year and next year as well, is to further work on our internationalization and getting key partners on board. There's also most probably going to be an advisory So another advisory board setup where there's the possibility for more ambassadors and kind of members from partnering associations or representatives from partnering associations to join ITSA in a more active manner. In addition, we're working with a couple of data vendors and data providers on licensing deals. So that's going to have to do with ITIN and ITC data in particular and how those can be redistributed. So this will again help help kind of those standards be more accepted standard and really do become the real standard that the market is using for classification and for identification of these tokens. And finally, we're also members, or we've created a task force together with the Digital Token Identifier Foundation in order to see what the synergies are and what the differences are between the DTI and the ITIN, and how e-trading software, DTI Foundation, and ITSA can work together. Because at the end of the day, we both have the same goal, which is to increase the safety and the transparency on the token markets, both through identifiers. Some final words on our, token base and the API. So the API is fully ready now, and it's available to active members with the key. There's a full documentation for it. And through it, you can, on the one hand, assign ITINs immediately. So we're integrating that as well with some security token issuers. So they're putting that into their kind of production cycle, that when they mint a new token, there's immediately an ITIN and an ITC assigned, and we get the necessary data right away into our database so that we can create a listing and token base. On the other hand, it can be used to retrieve all the data we have. So there we're in talks with a number of traders and funds who, on the one hand, want to use the ITIN to consolidate the price data, especially if they're doing high frequency trading, to consolidate the data they're receiving from different exchanges, because different exchanges often use different symbols and labels. Like classical or typical example, Bitcoin, it can be BTC, but it can also be XBT. And the ITIN can be used kind of to just consolidate all of the data under one identifier. And some funds are looking into using the ITC to run the necessary market analysis to work on their portfolio and their portfolio performance. Because now that we've classified a significant number of tokens, those ITC classifications can be used on the one hand to filter them. So you can analyze what the market is really looking like, in which industries there's movement, which economic purpose there are more or less tokens, and those kind of things. But you can also use it then to analyze any possible correlations between tokens or between categories of tokens and their price movements on the markets over time, and how those might connect. So those are kind of the ways we're moving forward. We're continuing with our webinars, planning to do 1 to 2 webinars a month now. So this is, for example, one of them, usually with partners, focusing a little more on the DeFi aspect, as well as relaunching our roundtables, which are, you can imagine, like a webinar, but behind closed doors and with a limited number of seats. Usually only 20 experts are invited to these, or there are 5 experts invited and 20 seats for experts which apply to the roundtable. So that way, we kind of want to ensure that there's really a small circle of true experts in their field in that particular topic that can use it to exchange their thoughts on the matter. And we will continue our membership, or restart our membership interviews, which you can see some of them already on our YouTube channel. They are really just quick 5 to 10 minute interviews with some of our members to see what they're about, and for everybody to see who else is a part of ITSA and who's moving in which direction. And I think that concludes the presentation from our side, unless Christian, you have some more things that you would like to mention.
Well, actually, I think you very well explained that.
Fantastic. And then in that case, we will be open to questions, but I think not for too long. Probably going to take 10 minutes from now, just to take any questions you might have in your post. Feel free to post them in the chat. And apart from that, I think Christian and I could just have a quick conversation on some of the upcoming topics. So some of the things Christian and I have been talking about were NFTs recently and how we can implement those in the ITIN. But I think the problems that we initially encountered there are essentially solved, right, Christian? And the plan is to just begin identifying them really and begin loading them up, and then using those token-based lists that you mentioned earlier to sort them by their different collections groups. So all CryptoPunks would essentially be in a list of items.
Mm-hmm. Correct. I think we are currently classifying the top 300 tokens according to CoinMarketCap. I think right now we are, at 60, 70 tokens already fully classified according to 10 dimensions. And yeah, basically the other 230 are following in the next weeks.
Super. Sounds good. Okay. Well, since there are no questions right now, I think I would end the stream. I'm going to post an email address in the chat so that it will be available once this is uploaded. So people that do have questions, feel free to send us an email if you see this pass. So once it's not live anymore, but once it's uploaded. So in the future, feel free to reach out to us, send us an email with any of your questions. The email is in the chat now. And then thanks to everybody that was watching, and hopefully see you soon in the next webinar.
Yeah. See you guys.